I'm so glad you're here. Today, we are going to talk about linear regression in human terms. There are lots and lots of resources out there, excellent resources out there, explaining linear regression, how it works, how to build it in code. Our free online textbook, which I'll link to in the video notes, will also walk you through it. But I want to do something a little bit different in this video, and I want to talk about what we're actually doing when we do linear regression, build some intuition, and especially if you're new to linear regression, or maybe you learned it once upon a time, but have unpleasant memories of learning it, or just kind of glaze over every time you hear about it, I'm going to do my very best to explain it in the most human terms absolutely possible. So I hope that is helpful. So when we talk about linear regression, a very common technique in statistics, it's the kind of first big statistical technique that most students will learn when they're doing statistics. And if you're in, say, the social sciences, econometrics, for example, or even doing basic machine learning, you're going to start usually with regression and then build from there. So it's really worth getting our heads around it. It's a jumping off point for a lot of more advanced statistics. All we're doing in regression is we are predicting the value of a dependent variable in our model, the thing we want to understand, based on the known values of the independent variables, the variables that we think drive that dependent variable. So regression analysis, more specifically, is a statistical method that we use to understand how one variable affects another. It finds what we are going to call the best fit line, and it's going to estimate a dependent variable, our y, on the basis of an independent variable or independent variables, our x or x's. We are going to generate something called a regression coefficient. This is going to tell us specifically the predicted effect of a one unit change in the known variable x on an estimated variable y. I am going to give you a very specific example in mere moments, but I want to lay this out so that we have it. And really, I recommend get through this, watch the example. And if you're like, wait a minute, what is the coefficient? Hop on back to this earlier part of the video. Regression coefficients are not unitless. They are expressed in the units of the variables. They are not symmetric. The predicted effect of x on y is not the same as the predicted effect of y on x. If you saw my last video on correlation, this is different. All right. If you haven't, correlation is different. We use regression to predict the effect of a change in x on y. There are lots of ways to do it in Python. I have some examples in my online textbook where we do it using a package called stats models. Feel free to hop over there and take a look if you'd like to implement it. But for now, let's talk about it in human terms. So this comes from the Harvard Business Review. Basically, what we're doing in linear regression, we're drawing a line and we're kind of saying some stuff about that line. In linear regression, we plot our data and we draw this best fit line, this line that summarizes the relationship between x and y in the simplest form of linear regression, which we're talking about here. So this line is telling us the predicted value of y given x. More specifically, what we're doing and what we're gaining when we conduct a regression analysis is we are understanding how the typical value of the dependent variable changes when the independent variable is varied. When there's more than one independent variable, we are understanding how the typical value of the dependent variable changes as we vary one independent variable, holding all the others constant. I'll give you an example of that to come. Typical value is usually the mean, but it doesn't have to be the mean. Linear regression is the most common technique out there. It's certainly, as I said, the first one that you will learn. If you learned nonlinear regression first, come talk to me. That's amazing. Almost always we learn linear regression first. The dependent variable must be continuous, and the relationship between the independent variable and the dependent variable is assumed to be linear. There are a number of other assumptions that need to hold, but these are two big ones that are real easy to violate. And if we violate them, our results may not make very much sense. All right. When we're doing linear regression with one independent variable, we call that a simple linear regression. Simple linear regression. This is where statistics gets awfully fussy with its language. Unfortunately, it's really important to make sure that you're using the right words here. So more than one independent variable means we are doing multiple linear regressions. You will hear people wrongly, I'm not writing it down because I don't want to burn it in your brain the wrong way. You will hear people wrongly refer to that as multivariate linear regression. That is not that. That is something else. I will say no more at this moment, lest I confuse. Ordinary least squares, or OLS, is a super common method for linear regression. It's not the only one. It's the one we're doing here. You may come across, as you continue, other techniques, weighted least squares, generalized least squares, nonlinear least squares. There's a whole other approach called maximum likelihood estimation, MLE, and there's lots and lots and lots more. If you could spend the rest of your life learning regression techniques and then hand-wringing over which one to use for which sort of analysis. That's basically the life of a lot of data scientists and statisticians and scientists generally. So welcome. All right, here's an actual example. We'll take it from public health. Shout out to my former co-instructor and friend, Professor Arthur Sperling, for this great example. So here's a scatter plot of the smoking rates in each of the US 50 states, that's the y-axis, and the tax rate on cigarettes in each state, that is our x-axis. So in general, gosh, it looks like the relationship is negative. So as cigarette taxes increase in a state, each dot represents a US state. As the cigarette tax in that state increases, we see that the percentage of people who smoke goes down. That's our association. It looks pretty linear. In my last video, I talked about how we detect linearity, and the answer is we take a good old look at it. For the most part, that is actually what we do. There are more other things we can do, but more often than not, that's plenty to get us started. So it looks pretty linear. We could make some arguments about that. It's not the strongest relationship I've ever seen. The Pearson's correlation coefficient is minus 0.43. All right. Again, see the previous video for more on that. So, okay. What do we know so far? We know that generally we can expect that the higher the cigarette tax is in a state, the lower the smoking rate is going to be. But we want to be more precise. Perhaps we are working in the government and we say, I want to change the tax rate on cigarettes. What would be the effect on smoking of a change in that tax rate? We could draw a line through this scatter plot that would summarize the relationship between X and Y. We're working in linear regression, so it is going to be a straight line. And we're going to do so using this equation. Now, dust off your old memories of algebra class, because you've seen this before. This is how we calculate the slope of a line. You probably saw it as y equals mx plus b. So that's where we're going to start, and that's how we're going to draw our best fit line. So the y here is our y variable equals a plus bx. So y is our dependent variable. A is the intercept. The intercept is the value for y when x is zero. That's our intercept. And then we're going to draw bx is going to tell us the slope. So b is the slope of that line, and x is the value for our independent variable. So y, we are saying we're working with linearity. We can say that y is a linear function of x. If you give me an a and a b, I can draw this line. You might be wondering, where does this a and b come from? We'll get there. Taking a closer look, this is the linear regression equation, and we can be more specific about how to interpret this. So of course, for a given x in our graph right here, y can take on different values. So for example, if x is 1/2, we see multiple possible outcomes. We see that the smoking rate for some states, you have smoking rates as low as 17.5 and all the way as high as, say, 28 and above. So y's can take on lots of different values for any given x in our data. This is where the mean comes in, the typical value for y. Fitting the best fit line to our data will then give us the estimates. Our intercept is 23.4. Our slope is minus 1.59. So we can calculate y equals 23.4 minus 1.59 times x. So 23.4, the value of y when x is 0, minus 1.59, the average effect on y of a one unit change in x. Our model's prediction thus is that a $1 increase, a one unit increase, a $1 increase in cigarette tax is associated with a 1.59 percentage point decrease in smoking in a state. That is our prediction. Are we right? Well, that depends on whether we think this is the right model for the data, whether we trust where the data came from, and whether we're missing perhaps other variables that might be playing a role here. But this is our prediction from our model. So cool, I think. There are trade-offs. We need to talk about things like statistical significance and other sorts of considerations, but let's bask in the glory of discovery for now. We made a prediction. Fun. All right, enough basking. We're done. More questions. We're scientists. We ask questions. Let's go. So first, consider the variance in y as x changes. Is it constant? What I mean by that is, as x increases, what happens to the variance of y? Well, it turns out the variance of y shrinks as we increase x. So when x is very low, y can take on a whole bunch of different values. And as we go across the x-axis, as we increase the cigarette tax, see, notice that the values for y get closer around the best fit line. We also have questions like, Is cigarette tax randomized to these states? Ideally, in order to really pin down causality, we want to do a randomized controlled trial where we say, okay, half of the states have low cigarette tax, half of them have high, or just randomly assign numbers to all 50 states. That would help us get a bit closer to understanding the relationship between smoking and cigarette taxes. Unfortunately, we can't do that. Fortunately, I guess, we can't do that. But we can think about what might be going on that could be messing with our conclusions. So what is the data generating process that's giving rise to these patterns? So for example, is it the case that cigarette tax is just decided on by the government in a vacuum apart from smoking rate? Is it the case that other things are going on in the state that are driving both the tax rate and the smoking rate? We need to go back and use our subject matter expertise and evaluate what might be driving these two variables. From a causal inference perspective, is there some endogeneity and specifically reciprocal causality in here? Yes, if a state has a high cigarette tax, it may have fewer smokers, but maybe it has a high cigarette tax because it has fewer smokers and they're trying to get cigarette revenue, or they can get away with higher cigarette tax because they don't have to worry about voters getting angry. It's not obvious which way the causal arrow goes, if there is one. Can you think of confounders? Is there some missing variable that could be predicting both cigarette tax and the smoking rate? So really, true glory, truest of true glory, belongs to those who make discoveries but have careful scientific thinking. So we generate our number, and that's barely step two of our project. Step three is ask all of these questions and try to answer them. So that's where we're going to really do some basking. So let's get into the slope a little bit more closely. So on average, Y changes by B units for a one unit change in X. So in other words, the percentage of smokers in our data goes down by, on average, 1.59 percentage points for every one unit change in X. In this case, every $1 increase in the cigarette tax. So on average, kind of the same thing over and over again, right? On average, increasing cigarette taxes in a state should lead to a 1.59 percentage point decrease in smoking rates in that state. So that means that if I'm right, given all those questions, we really need to think about all of those things. But if I'm right, give me any value for X. $200 minus 10. The government gives you money when you buy cigarettes. I can tell you the predicted percentage of smokers in that state. Now, the predicted percentage of smokers might not make any sense. It might, if we just follow this line to the extreme, end up being a negative amount or 100%. That's not necessarily valuable, though. I guess if the government gave out enough money, not all of us would smoke. I'd love to know what that number is. Someone calculate it and tell me. Let's say a little bit more about the best fit line. So we're drawing our best fit line. These are the states actually labeled. So shout out to New York, where I am, highest cigarette tax. We hate freedom. All right. And other shout out to Missouri, hanging in there with a real low cigarette tax. All right. Perfect. Notice that as we draw this best fit line, none of our predictions are perfect, except maybe Connecticut's pretty spot on. Hey, nice. Connecticut and Maine, I guess. And Florida. Okay. But most states are not actually at that best fit line. We can even be more specific and say, okay, New York is higher than our best fit line in terms of smoking rates. Hawaii has a slightly lower smoking rate compared to what we predict from our best fit line. Utah, way lower from what we predict from our best fit line. If you know anything about Utah, you can make some guesses about why it might be much lower, suggesting there are other components besides what's in our model to predict how much people are smoking. California, also lower. Kentucky is above the best fit line. Wisconsin is quite close, and so on. Little terminology for you. The gap between the actual values, the ones that I've circled, and the predicted values in our best fit line is called the residual. You will see that term all over the place. That is what the residual is, the gap between the actual data and the best fit line. Now, you've been wondering, as I've talked about this, how am I going to actually draw that best fit line? Therein lies the magic of OLS, ordinary least squares. So the best fit line is the one that minimizes the residuals. There's a lot of detail that we could get into about calculating it, but I want to keep this in human words. So we are looking for the line that minimizes the residuals, minimizes the gap between our actual and our that particular line. How do we make the residuals the smallest? So more specifically, we are drawing the line that minimizes the sum of the squared residuals, the sum of the squared residuals. And this method is called ordinary least squares. That is where squares comes from. That is where least comes from. The reason we're doing the squares is because otherwise the negatives and positives would cancel out. So we square the values for all of these residuals. So New York's residual is some number, Hawaii's residual is minus some number, California's residual is minus some number, Kentucky is a positive number. We square all of those, and then we find the line, and we could do it by hand. We could do it in the 70s on a computer that would take all day to crank it out or something like that, or we could do it in Python in two lines of code. Find that line for us. All right, there can only be one best fit line, truly, mathematically. There can truly be only one. This is too high. This is not the best fit line. This is not the line that minimizes the sum of the squared residuals. This is too low. Oh, just right. Yay. Have I said it before? I'll say it again. We are minimizing the sum of the squared residuals. That's how we're calculating it. As I said, if this is a stats class, we'd get into it. It's there. Maybe one day I'll make another video about that. Here is a more complete expression of OLS that you may see out there in the world. So our dependent variable is our y. You'll often see it written as beta 0, beta 1 as the intercept and the slope coefficient. And there is also a random error term to capture anything that is not captured in our model. And if you have more than one independent variable, it will be marked as beta 2, beta 3, beta 4 in our equation. All right, we'll leave that there. We're going to dive into what to do with our linear regression results and how to proceed with appropriate caution next.